بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise and thanks belongs to Allah, and may the peace and blessing of Allah be upon His servant and final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As to what follows, my dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Inshallah ta'ala, just in a few minutes, inshallah, what I'd like to share with you is some rulings and some rules regarding Salat Al-Fajr and Sunnat Al-Fajr. But of course, there's a lot of questions that come around in this topic, and when you're caught in the situation, you don't know what to do. So it's good that you have this knowledge beforehand. Inshallah ta'ala, I'll cover as many as important topics that we need to know in concern or in relation to this. Then I'll give you the chance that if you had any question, if we haven't covered, you may ask, and if we know the answer to it, inshallah ta'ala, we'll answer it. So very briefly, inshallah, firstly, Sunnat Al-Fajr, it is a sunnah that belongs to a group of sunan that are referred or known as Sunan Al-Rawatib. Right, as Sunan al-Rawatib are all, their ruling is a Sunnah Mu'akkadah. In other words, they are a stressed upon and emphasized Sunnah. And when we say Sunan al-Rawatib, what we mean by this is the two Rakat before Salat al-Dhuhr, the two Rakat before Salat al-Fajr, the four Rakat before Dhuhr, which is prayed two, then you make Taslim, then you pray two, and then the two Rakat after Salat al-Dhuhr, the two rak'at after Salat al-Maghrib, and two rak'at after Salat al-Isha. These are the 12 rak'at that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam promised that a house is built in paradise for the one who commits himself in terms of praying these rak'at. Those rak'at are known as as-sunan al-rawatib. So Sunnat al-Fajr, which is the two before Salat al-Fajr, that's considered among as-sunan al-rawatib. Therefore, it is a sunnah mu'akkada. So it's a stressed upon sunnah. Now, Sunnat al-Fajr, that's its name. Its name is Sunnat al-Fajr. But it also has another name, and that is al-raghibah. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam refers to it in ahadith, and the scholars refer to it in their sayings or in their opinions, in their books, as al-raghibah. The word al-raghibah, it comes from the word raghaba. And raghaba means to convince someone about something. So for example, if I was to say raghabtuhu bishira'i sayyara, for example, that means I convinced him, I persuaded him to buy a car. So that's what raghaba means. So it was called al-raghiba, these two rak'at of the Sunnat al-Fajr, they're called al-raghiba because of the emphasis that is placed upon them in the hadith, so much so that when you read them, you now become convinced that you'll pray them forever, right? And some of this is that we find in the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he never emphasized a sunnah more than he emphasized the sunnah of Salat al-Fajr. And so in the authentic hadith narrated by Bukhari and Muslim, that Aisha radiallahu anha, she said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was never ever more regular and particular in offering any nawafil other than the two rak'at of al-fajr, and that is the two sunnah of Salat al-Fajr. And in authentic hadith as well, narrated by Imam Muslim, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, rak'ata al-fajr khayrun min ad-dunya wa ma fiha, that the sunnah, the two rak'at before Salat al-Fajr, is better than the world and whatever is in it. You know, now I want you to think of this hadith just a little bit. You know, since the world has been created until the day of judgment, everything that exists inside of it, from ornaments to gold to silver to castles to luxury to houses to cars to family to wife to children, whatever it is, everything that's inside of it since it existed till the day of judgment, there is nothing that will equal to this. And what is actually better than this is those two rak'at that you pray before Salat al-Fajr. And why so? You think of this, why? Why is the two rak'at better than that? Because the two rak'at, they remain. They remain in your deed, while the world is something that's momentary. In other words, it's got a time and it will finish and it's gone. So, you know, when you die, whatever luxury you had, whatever wealth you had, whatever car you had, that's all gone. But what remains with you is what you did of acts. So this is why these two rak'at, there cannot be anything better than this. Because that'll follow you to your grave, it'll go straight in with you, it'll come out with you, and it'll go with you when you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But this world, as much as you have from it, the moment you die, there's nothing with you. And you know, just on this, I recall the story of a king. He said to his people that when I die, bury me, but when you bury me, stick my hands out of the grave. Bury me like this, and my hands outside of the grave. So they said to him, why? So he told them, so the people, they know me as a king, but let them know that when I died, I went into the grave and my hands are empty, there's nothing with me. Right? So this was the king that told his people to do this. In other words, it already gives the idea, and we already know, you die, you go to your grave, you have nothing except what you did of deeds, and this two rak'at that you do is of a good deed, that'll go with you until you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So next time you pray these two rak'at, which is the next thing you're going to pray after witr, right? Until, that's if you don't have something of the night prayer, but anyway, when Salat al-Fajr comes and you pray these two, think of it like this time, that there is nothing that you can possibly be doing right now better than these two rak'at. Yani even if someone told you, come collect $5 million, it's at the city, go collect it. Praying the two rak'at would be better than going and doing that. Or if someone told you, come pick up this car, I've given you a gift. Just keep in your mind that what you're doing now, there can possibly nothing be better than what you're in right now. So this is the emphasis that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put on these two rak'at. So this is why it was called al-raghibah. Because now, you know, after seeing all these ahadith and after understanding what importance it carries and what a huge reward it has, you're now convinced, al-raghibah, you're now convinced that you will never leave it again and you will pray it for the rest of your life. Okay, now, when is the time of this prayer? When is the time to pray Sunnat al-Fajr? Now, al-Aslan, in essence, the time for this Salat is between Adhan al-Fajr and the Iqamah for Salat al-Fajr. That's its time. So that's basically 20 minutes, half an hour, whatever the masjid gives to it. Ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah, he says that if you purposely leave praying it during this time, so say you came into the masjid, you sat down, and you wait for the Iqamah, and you said, I'll pray it after Salat al-Fajr, I'll pray it later. Then, if you pray it, it's not accepted anymore as Sunnat al-Fajr, because you left it purposely. If you leave Sunnat al-Fajr purposely, then if you pray anything after Salat al-Fajr of 2 units, it's only counted as a nafil, it doesn't get the reward of Sunnat al-Fajr. Right, so that's something keep in mind. Why? Because Sunnat al-Fajr, those two rak'at, it's part of al-rawatib. And the Sunan al-Rawatib, those 12 that we mentioned at the beginning of the lesson, they are a fixed worship. In other words, they come at fixed times, they must be prayed in their time. If you leave it and delay it purposely outside of its time, then you can pray, whatever you pray is known as a nafila. It won't be considered as a ratiba, right? So say for example, there's sometimes, you come into the masjid, they haven't made iqamah for Salat al-Dhuhr yet, and you prayed the Salat al-Dhuhr, and then you decide, all right, I want to pray those 4 rak'at that I didn't, I want to pray them now. If you left them purposely, then that's you pray them, but that's a sunnah for you, it's not counted as al-rawatib. So keep in mind that sunnah al-rawatib, those 12 rak'at, are at specific times and must be prayed at specific time. Now if accidental, or you forgot, or you were busy, you were rushing something, you didn't have the time, then you can make up for it later, and inshallah it's accepted as that sunnat al-ratiba. Okay, what is to be recited during the sunnah of al-fajr? What's to be recited? The first narration that we find in the hadith is that the Prophet ﷺ used to recite in the first rak'ah Surah Al-Fatiha, and after it Surah Al-Kafirun, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ. And in the second rak'ah also he'd recite Surah Al-Fatiha and Surah قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ after it. And of course we've mentioned and we've spoken about the wisdom behind this, but just for those that don't know, or we'll refresh that, is that Allah Azza wa Jal, He decreed this for us. And it was a sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So when we wake up on Tawheed. You see, Surah Al-Kafirun, it denounces shirk. لا أعبد ما تعبدون. I don't worship what you people worship. So it denounces shirk. Surah Al-Ikhlas, it affirms the oneness of Allah, the Tawheed. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد, to the end of it, right? So in other words, Allah Azza wa Jal wants us to wake up, right? Refreshing this idea of Tawheed in us and denouncing the shirk every morning. So that's one sunnah. The second sunnah is that the Prophet ﷺ has been reported that after Surah Al-Fatiha, in the first rak'ah, he'd recite قُولُوا آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَمَا أُنزِلَ إِلَيْنَا, to the end of the ayah, that's in Surah Al-Baqarah. And if you also look at this ayah, it's calling to Tawheed as well. And in the second rak'ah, he'd recite Surah Al-Fatiha, and then he'd recite an ayah from Surah Ali Imran. قُلْ يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ تَعَالَوْا إِلَىٰ كَلِمَةٍ سَوَاءٍ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ أَلَّا نَعْبُدَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ وَلَا نُشْرِكَ بِهِ شَيْئًا. Also, it revolves around the same idea of affirming the Tawheed and denouncing the shirk. So it is good that you mix up between this. Sometimes you do الْكَافِرُونَ الْإِخْلَاصِ, and sometimes you do these two ayat. Okay, now if you read anything else, that's also fine, there's no issue. But as long as it's in the duration of reciting Surah Al-Kafirun and Ikhlas, and it's not longer. And Ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he also said that if you read Surah Al-Fatiha by itself, that's also correct, there's no issue. So if you read Surah Al-Fatiha in the first rak'ah and in the second, and you recited nothing of any Quran after that, then that's also fine, because a condition of an accepted prayer, one of the conditions is to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, after that is a sunnah. Okay, so now we discussed that. What's the ruling on prolonging these two rak'at? So let's say we have someone that says, Wallah, I came to the masjid early and I witnessed the adhan, and so I want to pray these rak'at until the iqamah, mathala. I want to prolong the rak'at. It's a blessed time. A time between maghrib, between adhan and iqamah, is a blessed time. So he wants to prolong the recitation. He wants to take long in sujood, in ruku'. Then we said to this person, you went against the sunnah, because that wasn't the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It has never been reported that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prolonged these two rak'at. These two rak'at, it was always short. That's how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed them. And you know, and in this there's more encouragement in praying it, understanding that Rasulullah only shortened them and he never prolonged them. So, you know, you come in, if you come early, then pray them quick, right? You don't have to, in the meaning of quick, you eat the ruku' and sujood, that's quick. Take your time, but read these two rak'ah, these two surah, and it shouldn't take a lot of time out of you. And then use the remaining time till the iqamah to make dua. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that the dua is accepted between adhan and iqamah. So you use that time to make dua and shorten your prayer and pray it like the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us. Okay, now we speak about the ruling on the one who misses Sunnat al-Fajr. Right, let's say someone, he left his house, he didn't pray Sunnat al-Fajr at his house, and he came to the masjid late, and the people are already praying Salat al-Fajr. What does he do? So now we have two options. He comes, of course, he joins straight away, he joins the fard in the intention of fard, and he prays with them Salat al-Fajr. Then he can get up and pray Sunnat al-Fajr straight after it, after the tasbih, right? So, and the least of the tasbih is to say Astaghfirullah. Then get up and pray the two rak'at Sunnat al-Fajr, that's allowed. What's wrong is sometimes you find people, and this is not only with Salat al-Fajr, this is also with other salawat, is that mathala, you pray Maghrib, and automatically, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, he's up, he's praying. He's praying Sunnat al-Maghrib. Now that is not right. At least you should separate between al-Fard and Sunnah, at least by saying Astaghfirullah. And what's better is to make the tasbih and then get up and pray the Sunnah. So in this case, you came, you prayed the Fard with the people, then wait, make your tasbih, finish, then you're able to get up and pray Sunnat al-Fajr, which you have missed. The proof of this is a hadith we find on the narration of Qais ibn Amr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came out of his house and the iqama was made for Salat Al-Fajr, right? Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's house was next to the masjid, he would remain in his house. Once he walked out, when the Sahaba saw him, they'd quickly make iqama until he walked to the front and then he began to pray. So Qais ibn Amr is saying that this is what happened. The iqama was made and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prayed and we finished Salat Al-Fajr. And then he got up, right? This Qais ibn Amr, he got up and he started to pray two rakat. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned and found him praying. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got up and he told him, "Easy, O Qais, mahlan ya Qais, easy, relax, what are you doing?" He said to him, "Asalatayni ma'an," are there two prayers together? In other words, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is confused, what are you praying? There is no sunnah after Salat Al-Fajr, and the only farad in this time is Salat Al-Fajr, which he already prayed with us, so what are you praying? So then he said to him, "Ya Rasulullah, I did not perform my two rak'at before Salat Al-Fajr." So then the Prophet said to him, "Fala idhan," in other words, there's no harm, "Fala haraj," there's no problem. So that is the proof that you're allowed to get up straight after Salat Al-Fajr and pray the sunnah if you haven't prayed it yet, and of course after the tasbih. The other opinion is that you can wait till sunrise. Until the sun rises, then you can get up and pray your two rak'at and intend in that your two rak'at of Sunnat Al-Fajr that you missed. But now let's just say that you wait till sunrise. The question that comes up is, يعني مثلا, give this picture, you're in the masjid, you came late, you joined the jama'ah, you prayed the fajr with them, then you said, "Okay, I'm going to take the second opinion and I'll pray the sunnah after sunrise." So then you sat on the wall, you got the Qur'an and you started reciting till sunrise. Now, you'd want to pray the two rak'at al-duha as well. So what happens here, do you join them together and say, "I pray two rak'at in the intention of Salat al-duha and the two rak'at of Sunnat al-Fajr?" No, you don't do that. If you're going to take by the second opinion, then when the sun rises, that's 15 to 20 minutes after yani sunrise, you'd get up, you'd pray two rak'at first Sunnat al-Fajr, then you get up and pray two rak'at Salat al-Duha. Why? Because they're two different prayers that are not, you're not allowed to join them. They're two different prayers, they have two different intentions. Okay, now we're getting to the end of it. These are the very ones that usually happen, wallahu musta'an. And the first one of them is that if you wake up just before sunrise, by a minute or two, what do you do then? You woke up, let's say 1 minute. The sunrise today is, for example, it is 5:44. So you woke up at 5:43. Let's just hope your clock is a bit back so you can make the time. So you wake up 1 or 2 minutes before this. What do? Then what you do is you pray the fard first. That's what you pray. Why? Because you're still in the time of Fajr, and what takes preference is the fard more than the sunnah. So you begin with your fard immediately. And Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, he narrates in the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man adraka rak'atan qabla tulu'i shamsi faqad adraka as-salah, wa man adraka rak'atan qabla ghurubi shamsi faqad adraka as-salah." He said that whoever makes one unit, in other words, you make one ruku', the first rak'ah, and you get up from it, then you have made the prayer. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa said, if you make one rak'ah before the sun rises, then you have made the prayer. So in other words, if you prayed your first rak'ah and you got up from ruku' and now it's 5:44, then there's no problem, continue. Your Salat al-Fajr, inshallah, that one is incorrect time. You continue your prayer, you finish. And you don't have to rush it. You've already made it, so you take your time. And then after this, you pray Sunnat al-Fajr after sunrise, after that 10 to 20 minutes. So in conclusion of this, if you wake up 1 minute before sunrise, you immediately begin with Salat al-Fard. Once you finish Salat al-Fard, wait until the sun has risen and it's 10 to 15 minutes after that, then pray Sunnat al-Fajr. Okay, let's say that you woke up during sunrise. So you woke up at 5, if sunrise is at 5:44, you woke up at 5:46, 5:47. Now as the sun is rising, what do you do now? So what you do here, based on the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من نام عن صلاة أو نسيها فليصليها إذا ذكرها لا كفارة لها إلا ذلك. What you do is you get up, you make wudu, and you pray Sunnat al-Fajr and the Fard after it. This is during, right? There is another opinion, right? But wallahu alam, this is the most correct opinion based on the hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever sleeps during the time of a prayer, or whoever forgets about a prayer, then he shall pray it as soon as he remembers it. The emphasis is on the word, as soon as he remembers it. Nothing will wipe away his sin except that he does that. In other words, praise it as soon as he remembers it. So if you slept and you woke up, then don't worry about what time it is, just get up and pray. Whether it's during sunrise or after sunrise or whatever it is. And how you pray it, you begin with Salat al-Sunnah first, because the time is already out. So pray Sunnah first, and then pray Salat al-Fard. And the Prophet ﷺ says that Allah will forgive you if you pray that quickly. The only way Allah will forgive you for your sin of missing it is that if you pray it as soon as you remember. Okay, if you wake up after sunrise, let's just say it's 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock. Some people waking up at 9, 10, 12 o'clock, you wake up. And Allahu Akbar, it's 12 o'clock. You don't know whether it's daytime or not. What do you do? So in this case, it's the same idea. You'll pray the sunnah first and then the fard straight after. In this case, it happened with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions in one of the travels, one of the journeys they had. For subhanAllah, when you look at the sunnah and you just analyze it for a second, you realize that this actually did happen with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They slept and they only woke up when the sun was already up. It was already daytime, there was light. And they got up, and then what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do? He prayed Sunnat al-Fajr, and then he prayed al-Fard with his companions. And if that happens, you pray al-Fard and you're loud. And so the other opinion is that you do not recite loudly. Why? Because during the day when the light is out, there is no prayer that's prayed out loudly. But the night prayers are the ones that are prayed loudly. So if you do end up in this situation, then you have the option of either praying it loudly or praying it silently. And as I said, when you analyze this case, you find that Rasulullah ﷺ, he missed Salat al-Fajr with his companions. Did that happen? It's happened. It already happened. And it's in the authentic hadith. So why did that happen? You see, subhanAllah, this is how Allah teaches us. Allah Azza wa Jal decreed that case to happen on Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So through that we learn what to do, right? So there is nothing left in deen. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam went through that, he slept. Why? Because this ummah, people that come after him, it might happen. And it all happened, right? And it's happened. So now how would they learn what to do? Look at the case, Allah Azza wa Jal made Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that happen for him once. So we can learn the ruling of what to do. So you pray the sunnah, and then you get up and you pray al-fard after it. Okay, two more. What is the ruling on praying sunnat al-fajr for the traveler? Now, of course, the sunnah while you're in travel is that you leave the sunnah al-rawatib, all of them. You do not pray sunnah al-rawatib for a traveler, except the two rak'at of Salat al-Fajr. That was something that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam always prayed, whether he traveled or he didn't travel. Whether he was a traveler or he wasn't traveling, he was still in residence. So that's the exception. So these two, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never left. And it makes sense, it does make sense. Now, sometimes you'll find people, مثلا you go to Mecca, Medina, they'll pray the sunnah of dhuhr, the four rak'at. They'll pray four rak'at, and then they'll pray the dhuhr, and then they'll pray two rak'at after it. If you did that, there's no problem. But the sunnah is not to do this, and it makes sense. Why? Because if Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave the concession to the traveler to shorten the dhuhr, which is four to two, how does it now make sense that you pray four before and two after? If the fard itself was shortened, Right? If the fard itself was shortened, so of course the extensions that are to it before and after will disappear as well. Right? Otherwise, what would have been given preference is pray dhuhr for rak'at. So sunan al-rawatib themselves, these 12 rak'at, they are not a sunnah for the traveler except the 2 rak'at of Salat al-Fajr. And again, we can understand the logic behind this because the sunnah was that it's prayed quick. So it doesn't consume much of your time and it doesn't make you yani tired. As for the other nawafil prayers, for example, Salat al-Duha, Salat al-Witr, Salat al-Istikhara, 2 nafil prayer you just want to pray for Allah Azza wa Jal's sake, then all that is permissible. That's all a sunnah for the traveler. There's no problem in that for the traveler to do. So if you're in Mecca or in Medina, then make more of those rak'at, right? Those just, well, I just want to pray 2 rak'at for Allah. And make sure they're in the time of where you're allowed to pray, and that's no problem. Without intending sunnah al-ratiba. Okay, we come to the final issue, and that is sunnah al-fajr and tahiyyat al-masjid. So you enter into the masjid and the adhan has been called. What do you do? You've known something that's known as tahiyyat al-masjid, that's 2 rak'at. And then we also have this sunnah. So in this case, we have to base our answer on the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in where he says, إِذَا دَخَلَ أَحَدُكُمُ الْمَسْجِدِ فَلَا يَجْلِسْ حَتَّى يَرْكَعَ رَكْعَتَيْنِ. Pay very careful attention to this hadith. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying that if someone was to enter the masjid, then do not sit until you pray 2 units. So then the ulama called this tahiyyat al-masjid. They called it tahiyyat al-masjid, the prayer of greeting the masjid. But what that means is it's not 2 separate rak'at. In other words, if you walk in the masjid and you pray salat or sunnat al-fajr, have you prayed 2 units? Khalas, that's enough. That is enough. That means you have prayed Salat, Sunnat al-Fajr, and you've also incorporated in that Tahiyyat al-Masjid. Because Tahiyyat al-Masjid, some of the ulama, they say that it's not 2 exclusive prayers. It's any 2 rak'at you pray. So if you come in and pray Salat al-Fajr with the people, khalas, that's your Tahiyyat al-Masjid. You don't have to get up and say, Allah, I have to pray tahiyyat al-masjid, then I have to pray sunnat al-fajr, and then that's gone. The moment you pray any 2 rak'at, any 2, then tahiyyat al-masjid has dropped. You don't have to pray that anymore. So tahiyyat al-masjid isn't a prayer that's prayed for it being tahiyyat al-masjid. It's any 2 units you pray. So that means, in conclusion, if you come in, adhan has been called, now you have to pray sunnat al-fajr. You haven't prayed it at home, it's better to pray at home. But if you haven't, then come and pray 2 rak'at. You have now prayed sunnat al-fajr, and you've also went under this hadith that the Prophet ﷺ said, do not sit until you've prayed 2 units, and that is the 2 units. One more thing we mentioned is that there's an abandoned sunnah. There's an abandoned sunnah when it comes to Salat al-Fajr, and that is lying down. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reported that when he used to pray the 2 rak'at of Sunnat al-Fajr, he'd lie down until the Fajr. But now, to put this in perspective, Shaykh ibn Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he said that it's a sunnah to lie down, but in reality it's only a sunnah for who needs it. So if you feel like you were tired and you need that 5 to 10 minute nap, whatever it is, until it's iqama time, then do that, and you have you have done the sunnah, and then get up, and if you have to make wudu, make that wudu. But these 2, this sleep isn't supposed to get you to the stage of making wudu, right? It's just lying down, and then you get up and you pray with the people. And however, he said, if you do not need it, then don't do it. Right? Especially if you fear for yourself that you might sleep and you go into a deep sleep and you wake up after the time of Fajr, then that's not a sunnah in your case. So this is the conclusion, this is what we had. Inshallah ta'ala, before we take the questions, next week, either Friday or Sunday, I'll let you know, bi'ithnillah, we'll put a paper outside. We'll discuss the rulings regarding Salat al-Duha. And then the week after, the rulings regarding Salat al-Witr, and what issues that come up with this. Sorry, is there any other question? No? No.
So, did the Rasul pray Sunnat Al-Fajr in the masjid or
Sunnat Al-Fajr, of course, the Prophet ﷺ, he teaches us that any sunnah, it's best to be prayed at home, and therefore Nabi ﷺ used to pray it at home, and then he used to come out to his sahaba. It's also been narrated that he prayed it in the masjid, right? But for the most part of it was that he prayed it in the house, and he said that the best prayer, أَفْضَلُ صَلَاتِ الْمَرْءِ يَعْنِي فِي بَيْتِهِ إِلَّا الْمَكْتُوبَةِ, that the best prayer the person can pray, The prayer that you pray at home is always best for you, except the fard. That's better in the masjid. So any sunnah, whatever it is, it's always best to do it at home. And only the obligation prayer is the one that you pray in the masjid. And with this is the fact that... I forgot the hadith, if I remember I'll mention,
Do you know the wisdom behind praying loudly at night and in the daytime not praying loudly?
That was the case, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because the night, wallahu a'lam, is that things are more peaceful, things are more calm, there's much more attention span to listen to the ayat and ponder over the ayat, whereas during the day there is activity, there's movement, it's not as peaceful as the night. So therefore during the day the qira'ah was to be made silent for everyone, so as you hear your own self and you just reflect for what you're reading. Whereas during the night, it's a peaceful time, the Qur'an can be recited and people can peacefully listen and reflect, wallahu a'lam. Now.
نلاحظ في بعض المساجد الفترة الزمنية المقدرة بين الأذان والإقامة غير كافية. من شروط صحة الصلاة هو دخول الوقت.
أيوة.
إذا كان.
أيوة.
فبعض الأئمة يصلون صلاة الجماعة قبل دخول الوقت. في هذه الحالة هل نعتبر صلاة الجماعة سنة راتبة ثم نصلي؟
لا. He's just asking about people that pray Salat al-Fajr before its time. I mean, it's very obvious. I don't think there is a masjid that prays before the time that's on the calendar. طيب الحمد لله إذا هذه مشكلته. What he's saying is that it's happening in some of the Arab countries overseas. But I told him, it's not our problem here. But anyway, he's saying that if you pray before the time, but of course that's not an accepted prayer. And if you were to pray, then that's not counted as the fard. You still have to pray the fard after that. It's something common.
اي
معروف هذا. بس انا والله اعلم ما بعرف انه انسان يصلي قبل دخول وقت الفجر
هذا يحصل لانه طيب. يصلي 10 دقائق
طيب. قبل
الاقامه
اذا حصل
وفيهم من يصلي 20 دقيقه وفيهم من يصلي نصف ساعه
خلاص
10 دقائق قليله جدا قبل دخول الوقت
خلاص البارك كان يصلي في بيته صلاه الفجر
أيوة.
في المسجد كان يصلي قبل
طيب فمعناته اذا حصل ذلك وثبت من علماء ومشايخ انهم افتوا بضد ذلك فالأحسن أنه ما تذهب للمسجد من الأصل واجتنب ذلك الفتنة واذهب إلى مسجد آخر يصلي في وقته والله أعلم نعم
Yeah, sometimes you wake up 2 minutes before sunrise and in this case if you make wudu you're going to miss Fajr so do you make wudu or do you like
Okay, good That's a good question In this case, العلماء say الانشغال بالصلاة من الصلاة What that means is, let's give a bigger example Someone woke up and he needs to do ghusl Right, and there's only 2 minutes But what does he do? Make wudu or make the ghusl? Right, let's say he's got a bigger case He's got a bigger problem to deal with So in this case, we say take your time Make your ghusl, make your wudu and come out and pray the sunnah and then pray the fard. Because the ulama, they put the principle of al-inshighal bis-salah min as-salah. What that means is the activity you do for salat is part of salat. So when you're doing your ghusl or making wudu, what is that? Is that a preparation for salat? It is. Therefore it's part of the salat. So you don't run around and make tayammum because it's quicker and therefore I'll make the time. That's not correct. You make your wudu, even if the time is gone, that's inshallah ta'ala still accepted for you as it's in the time. Because you're preparing only for the salat, right?
Yeah.
طيب نعم.
Some people, when they come to the masjid, the congregation is already going on, but still they want to pray two rakat of sunnah before fajr. Is it allowed?
As the people are praying, the jama'ah?
Yeah, but the jama'ah is already going.
Okay, no. لأنه there's a specific hadith for that. The Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم says, إِذَا أُقِيمَتِ الصَّلَاةِ فَلَا صَلَاةَ إِلَّا الْمَكْتُوبَةِ. That if the prayer, if the iqama has been made for the prayer, then there is no other prayer except the fard, what people are praying. So wherever you are, in whatever rak'ah, just cancel it. The way you cancel the prayer is you hold your nose and you take your head to the right, and you've cancelled your prayer, and you come and you pray with the jama'ah. طيب؟ نعم.
Is it sunnah to read surah al-duha or salat al-duha?
Okay, inshallah we'll explain that when we speak about that. But whatever you read, there's no issue. نعم. إذا طلعت الشمس؟ Okay, there's the other question. He's asking that if the sun has already risen, all right, and there's a group that haven't prayed, then what do they do? That's answered in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. That happened to them, and they all got up and prayed jama'ah. So you pray jama'ah and you don't pray separate. And if you did pray single, everyone by themselves, then there's no issue. However, if you prayed the jama'ah, then inshallah, yani the reward of that jama'ah will be counted for you. That's in the case if you slept or forgot. But if you left it purposely, then you need to make repentance and tawbah from this.
What about if you say you wake up and it's already late, like 7, 8 o'clock,
and you
say, okay, I'll pray 9 or 10 after?
No.
What's considered about that?
Okay. So from the time you remember, and you say, all right, I'll play it 2 hours later, that's written now, begin the sins begin for you, until you pray it.
When you pray, is it still accepted like you
pray? Yes, but we'll be expelling the hadith. Nabi Sallallahu said, لَا كَفَّارَةَ لَهَا إِلَّا ذَلِكَ. That now you've woken up late, 7 o'clock. There's a sin. The only way that Allah will remove this sin is if you pray the prayer as soon as you remember it, he said, or as soon as you wake up. Therefore, if you remembered at 7 o'clock, you opened your eyes at 7 o'clock and you said, oh Allah, it's too late already, the sun's gone up. Go for another 2 hours and wake up. No, you've remembered it. Now that you're in serious trouble now if you don't get up and pray it. No.
Traveling, shortening the prayer. For Maghrib prayer, do you pray 3 or pray 2
rakat? Okay, no, Maghrib always remains 3 rakat. Maghrib never shortens because it's a witr of the day. Maghrib is witr of the day. So the day ends with Salat al-Maghrib and we end our day with a witr. So it has to be 3. And the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, end your night with a witr as well. So that's why at night we pray 1 rak'ah. So we end our night with a rak'ah, with witr, and we end our day with a witr as well, that's 3. Now. Shaykh
Sayyid, the last ayah of
Surah
Al-A'la,
how do you make sujood? كَلَّا لَا تُطِعْهُ وَسْجُدْ وَاخْتَرِقْ. Some of the ulama say that you will have to read after it at least 3 ayat. At least 3 ayat. And so, that's one opinion. The other opinion is you don't have to read anything. Just get up, and then from there say, Allahu Akbar, go into ruku'ah. And then get up from ruku'ah and make your sujood normal. So you make that sujood and then you get back straight back up. Now.
Do you know with what you said, I thought you just said SubhanAllah 3 times.
That's if you don't know the dua that I recited. However, if you know it, then that's the correct, and that's what Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said. سَجَدَ وَجْهِي لِلَّذِي خَلَقَهُ وَشَقَّ سَبْعَ وَبُصَرَهُ فَتَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ. It's found in Sunnat al-Muslim, you'll find it, and it is a narration in Bukhari and Muslim. Now.
You pray sunnah at home, Rakat, and you come to the mosque, and you have a time still to pray to Rakat. Can you pray at the masjid?
Yes, of course, yes. So if you pray to Rakat in the masjid at home, and you come to the masjid, then you're allowed to pray 2 rak'at, intending them they are the 2 rak'at before I sit. Yeah.
Just regarding the travel, when he travels to Mecca or Medina, So you eliminate the all the sunnah prayers except for Sunnat Al-Fajr.
Yani you have the concession of leaving all Sunan al-Rawatib, which are the 12 rak'at we spoke about, except the 2 rak'at of Sunnat al-Fajr.
But even if you're in the masjid, the one imam.
Whatever it is. Because you're a traveler. As long as you're a traveler, leave Sunan al-Rawatib, that's the Sunnah. Except the 2 rak'at of Sunnat al-Fajr. Now, anything else of Sunan, as we said, Duha, al-Witr, anything else you can pray now.
Yeah, but is it permissible to recite the Quran without wudu?
Permissible to recite Qur'an without wudu? Yes, he can recite the Qur'an without wudu. Yeah, there's no issue. However, there is khilaf in this. But wallahu a'lam, let's just say that the better to do is do not touch the mushaf without wudu. Right? The ulama used لا يمسه إلا المطهرون as a proof. Some other ulama responded to that and said that's not actually proof for that. But whatever it is, the better for you is to make wudu when you want to touch the mushaf. What we mean by mushaf is everything, right? And some would say only the words. But it's just best for you that before you touch the mushaf, make wudu. Otherwise, you can read Quran with or without wudu. From your memory, read with or without wudu. Even if you're in a state of janaba where you have to make ghusl, you can also recite Qur'an. The other opinion is that you're not allowed, but the proof for reciting is that it was narrated that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam كان يذكر الله على في كل حين. That Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to remember Allah from time to time. So it never specified that during ghusl or janaba time he never used to, right? So but it's better that I'm saying better for you to have wudu. Allahu Akbar. But the better is that
there's a difference of opinion.
There's a huge difference of opinion. It's an issue to be studied. Although, look, when you search it, you'll find that al-ijma', the consensus of the ulama, is that you're not allowed to touch the mushaf except with wudu. That's the ijma'. That's the consensus, right? So then you have other madhahib that went against this, and with their other different proofs. Like, no.
You came to church late, you entered the second rakat, and you finished, and now you're getting up to continue. You pray out loud or silently?
Right, so you've missed the first...
Same thing for Maghrib Mahshad, if the out loud prayers,
uh-huh.
You need to make...
Yes, okay. Alright, so here in this case, you continue, you remain silent, and you pray silent. Why? Because you're going to have many other people with you that will get up, and they're praying their salawat. So to avoid this confusion with people, you remain silent. The only time you'll read out loud is if someone came and joined with you. So now you prayed with the imam. You made one rak'ah with the imam. And you got up for another rak'ah. Someone came in late and tapped you and is praying with you. That's allowed, right? You don't have to go pray by yourself. Join with whoever had already joined the initial jama'ah. When you do this, now you raise your voice so they can hear you, right? That's in that case, then it's no problem. Now.
I don't get clear with the praying sunnah after tasbih.
Okay, so what we said there is, the ulama said, do not pray sunnah prayer immediately after the fard. So you say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, you get up, Allahu Akbar. There is people like this. Maybe the imam hasn't finished as-salam and he's already, what is he praying? He's praying sunnah. So here the ulama say, before you pray the sunnah, separate between the fard and the sunnah at least by saying astaghfirullah. Make the tasbih, and the tasbih is a sunnah after the fard, not after the sunnah. Finish that, then pray the sunnah. That's what it means. Now,
if you are on 15-hour flight, are you allowed, or are you is it mandatory to pray?
To pray the salawat?
Yes.
Of course. If you're on a flight, then what you do is you estimate the time of your position. Where you are, what the time is, you pray. You don't base it on the time of your country or the time of destination, where it is. You estimate your time where you are, what the time is. Open the window, look at the time, look at the map that tells you on the flight, you're on top of India, for example. So go to your phone, see when India pray, and what is the time in India. You can do all this offline. You don't need the phone to be connected to internet or anything. What the time is, and we're on top of India. Wallah, Dhuhr in India is 12 o'clock, And the time in India now is 11. So that means give 1 hour and pray Salat al-Dhuhr.
And you pray
Asr with it.
You pray while you're sitting down? Or?
If there is space to stand up, then a condition of an accepted prayer is that you stand up and pray. However, if you cannot stand, there's no space for standing, then what do you have to do except that you sit down and pray seated?
One last thing, if you're praying, and do you need to recite Quran in order, like you recite قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٍ, is that
okay? Okay, so when you're praying, you pray in the first rak'ah, second rak'ah, then you pray and you read the surah or ayat.
Yes.
If you're reading surah, then there's no problem, they don't have to be in order. So if in my first rak'ah I recited قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ, well, there's nothing after it. And in the second rak'ah I prayed and I said قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ, that's no problem. However, I cannot pray within one surah and go behind. So what that means is I don't say Allahu Akbar and I read قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ, I read the Fatiha. Then I say مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ, just that ayah. Then in the second rak'ah, I recite from the same surah from the beginning, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ. That's wrong. Within the same surah, if you were to read something from it, then in the second rak'ah, you cannot read anything before it, except only after it. But if it was surah in the complete surah, then there's no issue. You can read this one, and then you read that, as long as it's a complete surah. But within the surah, you must read it in order. Now,
I wanted to ask something, you know, like, wherever you go, whichever masjid or salah you go to, you know, like there's some people who leave the gap and while praying, leave the gap, you know. And then you try to stretch it as much as you can, but then sometimes there are some people who they just take offense or something, that they just take
all right,
so
good.
They take their foot away, you know. Like,
Okay. So this issue actually goes back to putting your feet or your يعني, sticking the feet with the feet of the brother that is next to you, right? So now we know that the Sunnah, it spoke about يعني, placing the feet with the feet and the shoulder to shoulder, right? And this Imam al-Bukhari has a bab, he says, بَابُ إِلْسَاقُ الْقَدَمِ بِالْقَدَمِ, the chapter of gluing the feet to the other feet. Gluing, basically يعني, like this. Now the ulama, when they spoke and يعني, interpreted this hadith, they said that only should happen at the beginning of the salat. So in other words, when the imam is making the line straight, at the beginning, he makes sure everyone is right next to, tucked with each other, and that the feet are right next to each other. That's just at the beginning, to make sure the line is straight. What happens after this, you got up, sujood, and then the feet moved, and khalas, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it, leave it. Leave it. Because the purpose of it was to make the line straight. That was the purpose of it. The purpose of it wasn't to keep you going in the prayer and see where the foot is and keep following it, right? This is Shaykh bin Uthaymeen rahimahullah, he mentions this. He says the purpose of sticking, gluing the foot to the foot is to make the line straight. If that's done at the beginning of the salat, alhamdulillah, don't focus on that anymore. If the foot slightly moved because there was movement in the salah up and down, then that's fine, just keep going, right?
Sometimes in cases, there's people, they just intentionally leave the gap, you know, like they don't just
sort of... I don't know about intentionally because, like, yeah, I mean, my own intention, I don't know.
It's this big gap, you know, it's this big gap, that's yeah. Not like normal.
No, yeah, I mean, look, in cases like this, in cases like this, you try to close the gap as much as you want. As much as you can, you try to close the gap, but you do not now strict and be into that motion, because the purpose of the gluing was to straighten the line. Once that's done, the up and down movement automatically is going to separate the feet. So if that happens, that's fine, don't concentrate on that anymore. Now,
just about sitting on the plank, you had no space to stand, you had to sit in a Qibla direction,
all the way. Qibla. Alright, so the Qibla direction is very simple. Now, you're not able to stand. The only place you can pray is in this seat. And unfortunately, you cannot pray the seat. If it's directed to the Qibla, alhamdulillah. If not, ask them to turn it. If not, you just pray. You pray. But if the plane lands and you're still in the time of that salat, get up and pray it again. If you're still in the time of Salat. So if you prayed Salat al-Maghrib in the plane, and then the plane landed and there's still half an hour for Maghrib, pray that Maghrib again, because you're still in the time. However, if you land after Isha and the time of Maghrib is gone, then khalas, you've prayed it, you don't have to pray it again. So these are conditions, the Qibla, the standing and so on. If you cannot, and Allah Azza wa Jal knows that you cannot, therefore you have an excuse. Nah, طيب. أيوه.
جمهور الفقهاء أجمع على كان يصح القرآن مزود والنبوء والمزود.
أيوه. That you're not supposed to touch it without wudu.
Reciting.
لا لا. Everyone أجمع. ما في إشكال. Read with the Quran without wudu.
جمهور الفقهاء.
أيوه. ما في إشكال. أيوه. ما في إشكال أبدا. ما في إشكال.
Yes.
But of course, min al-adab, from the etiquettes of reading the Quran, is that you have wudu, you face the qibla, you use the siwak, right? These are from the etiquettes of reading Quran. Imam al-Nawawi has a very beautiful book. He said the book is Adab Hamalat al-Quran. The etiquettes of the people that carry the Quran, the people that recite the Quran. And he mentions a list of etiquettes. And the beginning of them is that you have wudu, you face the qibla, right? You're not sleepy or lazy. You have the siwak, you use the siwak before you recite. And then there's so many etiquettes, adab of reciting. It's a very good book and a good read to understand any of these etiquettes. Now,
You said that you can pray the rakat instantly after the fajr. That's what, like, if you, because I heard that you can't pray after fajr, but that's the only time you can pray after fajr, right?
We said that if you prayed with the jama'ah and you haven't prayed the sunnah, you can pray it.
Yeah, but I'm saying, for example, let's say I want to pray the qatan.
All right, no.
You can't. Yeah.
No, then in the time, there are three times where you're not allowed to pray anything. There's the time of between sunrise and that 20 minutes after it. Before Salat al-Dhuhr by 10 minutes. That's the known as Waqt al-Zawal, when the sun is right in the middle. You cannot pray in that time. And there's the time of just before Ghurub al-Shams, from after Asr to as the sun sets. These are times that's forbidden to pray. However, if you're in Mecca, you pray any time, right? There's a special hadith that if you're in Mecca, then there's a hadith that says, do not prevent anyone from praying, whether day or night. So whatever time it is, you're allowed to pray there. Other than that, Salat that Asbab, you can pray. So for example, if we have Salat al-Janazah or Salat al-Kusuf, the eclipse prayer, you pray that. Salat al-Istisqa, if they were to pray, then you pray it at those times. There's no issue, there's no harm, inshallah. But يعني, for the most part of it, those times are prohibited. Pray absolutely nothing. Now, then we have ikhtilaf in tahiyyat al-masjid. If you come into the masjid, then it's what's, يعني, you can pray it, but when it comes close to sunset, do not pray. Yani that 5-10 minutes before sunset, just don't pray there at all, because that's the time when the mushrikun are doing their worship. Of course, if you haven't prayed Asr, then you have to pray during that time. Now, طيب. We have one more question. Or last one here. Allah, one more there.
You said when the jama'ah started and you're praying in sunnah, you hold your nose and elaborate more about
the evidence. Yeah, the evidence is found in hadith that the Prophet ﷺ was described that when you leave the salat, you hold on your nose and you give a taslim to the right. That's the way of exiting the prayer. So it gives the idea of that you didn't just leave like this, maybe some bleeding nose or something like that. It gives a different image of you just cutting the prayer like this. So there was a respected way of coming out, and a way of this is the way that the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had taught. It isn't that hadith until I find it, we'll share it. Bye.
Two questions. One is, like you said, if the whole group has missed out on the Fajr time, and afterwards they can do the Jama'ah.
No.
Right? So do you still intend the Niyah as the Qadha, or you just carry on just the
Fajr? No, there's no Qadha. The Qadha is only for people that intentionally missed. But you missed it. So you didn't intend you're going to do Qadha. So you get up, and of course that's your Salat al-Fajr. And you pray the Sunnah before, and then you pray Salat al-Fajr. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.